praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Every praise. You are God, every word of worship. One accord. Amen. What an awesome God we serve. Amen.
Amen.
What a, such a great scripture. The thing this Lord's read. And from Jeremiah. It's just, you know, that scripture's kind of warm and cuddly. It reminds you of the goodness of God and His love toward us. And oh, why we should love that wonderful name of God. You know, it's, you know, last week when I looked out, it looked full. I was like, man, we. And then I looked around, I was like, man, and most of these are people who were members or are members. And then today we back to that faithful group of folk. But God is still good. He's doing something. And He's doing something in each one of you. Man, what a joy it's been to teach class and to be amongst the saints of God who are trying to live a righteous life. And we was worried about Sister Carolyn. But y'all, I got to tell on Sister Carolyn, she was cheating on us. She was out in California in 80-degree weather. And she left us back here. But she sent some this way. She brought it back with us yesterday.
Amen.
Amen. What a glorious day. Amen.
Amen.
That the Lord has shown us. We're thankful for Brother Aaron, who traveled all the way back from Ohio to be with us. Amen. His faithfulness and loving kindness toward us, we are just so appreciated. And his wife and his children allow him to be a part of our ministry as well. And they were with us last week. That's supposed to be his vacation. And we couldn't find a replacement for him when he's out. So he drove all the way back to be with us. And we're thankful for that. We're thankful for Brother James.
Yes.
Yeah. Amen.
Amen. I think we got him worked up in a little sweat this morning. Amen. Amen. Well, we thank God that Brother James is a quiet soul unless he really know him. And then he'll talk. But we thank God for his quiet spirit. They will say, where the boys at? That's what we ought to say. Where the boy? When they miss him, we ought to know where they at. Amen. Amen. Because he faithfully has them with him. We thank God for our own Deacon Robeson. Amen. Playing the bass and doing what he can. If I don't call your name, it ain't your week. Amen. Amen. I got to thinking. I said, I'm calling people names, and normally you get in trouble. This just ain't your week. Your week's coming. I'm just talking about the musicians today. Amen. Amen. I tell you, the demon is broken. So you got covering tracks. I was teaching y'all that yesterday. Amen. So we're thankful. So let's go to the word before I get in trouble. Last week we started that message of love, and man, we didn't really hardly get a chance to get into it good, and time was up. And so we want to look at Matthew. We're going to continue. Matthew chapter 5, verse 38 through I think it's 43 where I read last time. As we're embarking on Easter, I think what a great day, what a great opportunity that we started molding ourselves into Easter with the day of love, which was Valentine's Day. Amen. We said what an act, what a show of love that God has given us when we embark on Easter Sunday. And so it reads like this: stand for the reading of the gospel, Jesus Christ. I'll be reading again from the NASB. I'm the NASB guy, which is the New American Standard Bible. And so 38 through 43. And so it reads like this: you have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye, and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, do not resist an evil person. But whoever slaps you on your right cheek, turn the other to him also. And if anyone wants to sue you and take your shirt, let them have your shirt and your coat also. Whoever forces you to go 1 mile, go with him 2. Give to him who asks of you, and do not turn away from him who wants to borrow from you. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. And the people of God said, amen.
Amen.
You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Father, we thank you for this time, God. We're so grateful and thankful for a life, health, and strength, and opportunity to stand before these your people. Father, we don't really care about what Eugene thinks or what Eugene has to say. So God, allow him to decrease that your Holy Spirit may increase, and that it might speak a word, causing young men, boys, and girls to fall out of love with the word and fall in love with Jesus. And Father, we don't come to put in the show because we're not at the movie party. Father, we are not a television program that is here to entertain in comedy or horror or suspense. But Father, we are here to speak a word that will cause young men, boys, and girls to fall out of love with the things that the world has offered unto us and make Jesus our choice. Father, here I stand, God, in no authority of my own. But one day that you had called me out of the darkness into your marvelous light. You told me to God that according to thy word, to preach thy word. Preach it in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, with all long suffering. God, I stand here according to thy word because of thy loving kindness. Oh God, use me, this vessel, to speak to these your people. Thou art the potter, we are the clay. Use us on that potter in me. Speak a word that would help somebody along the way. Lord, we thank you in advance for what's about to happen. And it is in thy Son, Jesus' name, we do pray. And we say, amen. Amen. We talked about from this title of this text, How to Love as God Loves Us. Amen. There's something in the title that puts a quickening in my spirit on how to love. I must admit, as a young man, Brother Eugene, that I thought I knew how to love. I thought my love that I was given was sufficient according to my own rules. But then I became a child of God, and I found out that my love was not enough. The love that I had been giving was a superficial, Sister Giselle, kind of love. And I knew my love wasn't real when I found out and came to an understanding that my love was predicated upon certain situations and the way I was treated. Amen. I knew my love wasn't real. Because in order for me to love, Ms. Campbell, they had to give me that in which I felt I desired. And when they achieved giving me that in which I felt like there was love toward me, then I was willing to give my love back. But then when I came to understand what love really was, I found out just how cheap, broken down, uncommitted, unresponsive love that I had been giving. And I found out what real love was about when I met Jesus. when I found out that Jesus loved me, Sister LaShawn, in spite of me. Y'all ain't hearing what I'm saying. Amen. I found out that no matter what I had done to Jesus, no matter how I had treated him, no matter how I had scandalized his name, Jesus still loved me. And there was an excitement that rose up on the inside of me when I found out that God loved me. According to scripture, he loved me enough. Now, wait a minute. That he sat in heaven, not needing a thing. God didn't need nothing. Didn't need me. Didn't need you. Didn't need this world. Didn't need these people. God was sitting in the perfection of his own home. You hear what I'm saying to you? Amen. In God's heaven, in God's home, there's no sickness, no disease, no fornication, no adultery, no murdering, no lying, no backbite, no cheating in the comfort of his own home. Right. Amen. Now, I don't know about you, but there's a confidence when I'm in my own house. Amen. There's a confidence in knowing. Let me have a quick sidebar. I knew that a home meant something when Gene moved out of mine and into his. Amen. Y'all hear what I'm saying? Because I went to his house and tried to tell him some stuff that I had commanded in my house. And he reminded me that that was his house. Y'all ain't hear what I'm saying? Amen. There's a confidence of Deacon Lewis in Deacon Lewis's house that he's the king of his castle. Amen, because he can't come to 4390 Castle Bay Drive 46254 and tell me what to do in my castle. So there's a different confidence at 4390 than there is at Waterloo Drive. Amen. Amen. Can't tell D. Lewis what to do at Castle Drive, Waterloo Drive. Can't tell him what to do. That's his castle. So there's a confidence. Amen. Amen. We share our castles with our queens. Amen. Who have something to say about our castles. And I'm going to leave that at that. And so last week, And we got through point number one. And it was, allow Jesus Christ to transform your traditions. Amen. We need the Word of God to transform that in which we say is tradition. And we see that in Matthew chapter 5, 43. He said, you have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. Jesus is referring here in the text to the teaching of the Pharisees and the scribes. Their teaching was not in line with the Word of God. We talked about it in deacon's training and in enrichment hour. Some of you guys have missed some powerful stuff that we have to be careful with our opinion. Amen. Because your opinion really has no and bears no weight in heaven. Amen. What transforms people, a deacon told me, is the truth. Amen. Some of us got so many opinions that and the truth is so far from us that we believe our opinion is the truth. Now, I need to say that for the cheap seats. Amen. Some of us have so many opinions that we have decided that that is the truth. Amen. Amen. But I want you to know today that it's, the Bible says, it is the truth that will make you free. Amen. And so truth has to transform. Truth don't have to transform. It does transform. And it says in transformation, transform you by the renewing of the mind. See, when truth grabs a hold of truth and it transforms the mind, the mind begins to transform the body and the soul. But see, the Pharisees in the text, they were more concerned with themselves than they were with the truth of God. And so in the text, they had transformed the truth to their opinion. And their opinion was, is that you should love yourselves more than you love your neighbor. What they were doing, they were subtracting from the Word of God. And they were adding to the Word of God. Scripture says, don't add nothing to or take nothing away from that what God has wrote in the scripture. Amen. And so the Pharisees, and we talked about it this morning in Leviticus, we talked about how God had given Aaron, amen, the law of atonement and how to carry it out. And Aaron did it exactly that way. And Aaron placed a pin upon it to say, now that I've done it exactly how God has given it to me, now you go out and do it exactly how I have given it unto you. What Aaron was simply saying is, he did not want us to form our own opinion. He did not want them to invoke their own thought process, but stay within that and which God had given unto them. The law of God states in Leviticus 19 and 18, you shall not take vengeance, nor bear any grudge against the children of your people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself, for I am the Lord. I want you to know in the text, the Pharisees, they have omitted from their teaching of the two words. as yourself. Amen. Talked about that last week, how we love ourselves and take care of ourselves. You know, I'm soon to have a grandbaby and my step-grandbaby over there. Not my step-grandbaby, my god-grandbaby. I love them. Love them to death. I let them get away with stuff that I didn't let my kid. And I see her smacking me upside the head. And I'm just smiling and grateful. JJ or Jenna would have did that. I'd be done gotten a little grip. But it's something about grandchildren. Amen. That we loosen the belt and allow them to get away with some stuff. Not only were they obeying from God's word, they were adding to it. Now, there is nowhere in the word of God where it says, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. And, you know, he's reiterating this thought process of the Pharisees trying to control the people. I want you to know today that God is love, and God loves all of us. Regardless of who they are, how they act, what they believe, I am to love people. That's the call. Okay? You are to love everybody. The Bible tells us that even those that use us and take advantage of us, it says, love them that despitefully use you. Amen. God, and what God is referring to is he wants us to be little G's, little representations of him, that people might see the true God. Y'all hear what I'm saying? Does that make sense? Let me break that down. And what, when we say, Sister Evans, when we say that we are Christ-like, that we have attributes of God, that we are Christians, in essence, we're saying we're Christ-like, and we have attributes of God. That's what we're saying. Let's understand that God is love, we love God, and God, and as lovers of God, we ought to love his people. Okay? We track it on the same sheet of music? Amen. Because when we didn't love God, because anybody, let me ask a question. That way I know I'm speaking to the right group of people. When we came out from the womb, did we love God? Did we always live a life or try to please God? The Bible says that we was born in iniquity and shaped in sin. Amen. That means that we had to learn. Amen. When my grandbaby come out, my grandbaby is going to be so sinful. And it's going to be simply because when it's hungry, it's going to do something, cry to get something to eat. Then when it finds out it can cry to get something to eat, it's going to cry all the time. Amen. And I'm sure my daughter-in-law is going to do that. But when she at my house, there's going to be a different set of rules. She says she hungry, I'm going to feed her.
Yeah.
Amen. That's one good thing about being a grandparent. Amen. When she's being bad, I'll be like, oh, whoop my baby. Mm-hmm. Same thing Norma said to me. She's like, I got to go. You about to whoop one of my grandbabies. I was like, you better go then. And the life of a grandparent is different. It's different than a parent. And so we let them get away with some stuff that ordinarily we don't let them home get away with. And so God wants us to, he says, how do you love? And so we're dealing with today, how do I love as God loves? Well, the first thing we said last week, we said, allow Jesus Christ to transform your tradition. You know, traditionally, I thought love was this little bitty, we just celebrated this little bitty thing that flew around with some wings and a little bow and arrow. And when he shot you and she became a twinkling eye, that was love. She loved me, mama. And I love her. So we're going to be boyfriend and girlfriend. Well, he's not good for you, but I love him. Amen. We see that kind of love. We see that superficial kind of love in a lot of places. Amen. But today, we want to talk about allow Jesus Christ to widen your witness. If you love God, you gotta come out of that stereotypical introvert and become extrovertedly or outward appearance in your love for God. Amen. You want people to know that you love it. Amen. And why you love it. And so we have to widen our witness. Look at what the word says. Look at the word. You know, we teach it these next few weeks. He says, but I say to you, love your enemies. Bless those who curse you. Do good to those who hate you. And pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you. One of our great witnesses for Jesus Christ is not always with our lips, but with our confidence in Christ. Our joy in the Lord as we endure difficult times and difficult people. Amen. We widen our confidence. We widen our witness of when we show Christ in difficult times. Can I get witness, LaShawn, that it's easy to serve God when everything in your life's on the mountaintop? Everything good, your money, your pockets full of money, and all your bills are paid, your boyfriend, your husband, your wife, she acting right, and you know, everything at work is good. I am the picture perfect servant of God. I'm doing well. I don't have to worry about it now. I'm just going through life. Amen, and I'm enjoying it. But instead, do I have that same spirit, that same love for God when I'm going through difficult times? Now, I'm confused with some people. And it's okay. I mean, you got to work this salvation thing out for yourself. But instead, when people are going through difficult times and being persecuted by the enemy, it's when they stray from God. There's an old school song. I got some old school folk in here. There's an old school song that used to be sang in the church. If you ever needed the Lord, sure do need him now, right now. Or when I was coming up as a kid in the pew, boy, when that came on, the church got hot. If you ever needed, and people, you look at people, and they would have this determination. And I'd be like, they must be going through. But they would see it with passion and conviction. Show do need him now, right now. And so they was running to the church, they was running to God, they was running to the place and where the Spirit of God dwells. To get some help. But in 2016, this new millennium church, man, they running from the church. When times get tough, going gets tough, they are running from the church. We have to allow the Christ to widen our witness. Notice Jesus did not say, get all depressed and ticked off when people get upset with you. He didn't tell us to go cry and pout about it. He said, give up. He didn't say give up or have a pity party. Understand the way that the world says to love and the way Jesus teaches us to love is vastly different. The world says love those who like you. Love your friends. Love those that love you first. Love those that bless you. And those are the world's standards. But God's standards of love God says in the text, he said, love those that hate you. That's a bitter pill to swallow. I've been getting a lot of bitter pills lately. That's a bitter pill to swallow to tell me to love somebody who's not reciprocating my love, but they're giving it back as hate. God says to love you. As a Christian, Jesus Christ did not promise everyone would love you. Matter of fact, as a Christian, he didn't promise that everyone would like you. In fact, he says in John 15:19, if you are of the world would love its own. Yet because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. Amen. Amen. For my people who are keeping score, that's John 15:19. As a young person, if you stand up for the word of God, about your faith in Jesus Christ our Lord, if you say, no, I can't do that, y'all. I can't do no drugs because I love God. Yeah, I can't do a skip the school party and go drink alcohol with y'all because I love God. Ladies and gentlemen, if you're a young man or a young woman and you tell the person that you're dating or that likes you, you say, no, I can't do that because I'm saving myself for marriage in the sanctity of God. And you let them know that sex outside of marriage is wrong. People, you are going to be talked about. Young folk, you're going to be ostracized. We called it in our day, we would call different kind of folk that wasn't like us, L7s, which means there's an L and here's a 7. Square. Call you a square. Man, what's wrong with you? This is the thing to do. I want you to know that there are going to be some L7s in heaven. And there are going to be some folk who tried to talk you out of being an L7 in hell. So young people, I encourage you today to keep your faith. Telling you to walk with God. Your choice as followers of Jesus Christ is to choose your response in love. You can't choose how people respond to you. But you can't choose to walk in love and obedience according to God. Told you we don't got nothing for you but the truth. Listen, let me say this. I have compassion for people. I love God's people. But there's certain stuff I just can't go along with. And it's not because Sister Giselle, I'm perfect. Brother Adams, it's not because of that. I'm against it because God is against it. Huh? That ought to be reason enough. Amen. Amen. I don't care who's for it. You know, all this stuff that's going on out here and people saying, well, we in 2016. God said, I'm the same God yesterday, today, tomorrow, and forever. Listen, I don't care if you're my child acting a fool. I saw Will Smith on a little clip. And they was asking him about his son. What's his name, Gene? Jaden. And this new fashion style he's wearing. And they asked him the question. He said, do you think you got, you know, y'all let him get too far out there? And Will said, yeah, I think we did. You know, he said, I applaud him because he's brave to do what he's doing. But I think we were too lax. I want you to know today that when you are lax in the things of God and you're not carrying out what he has called us to do, you can end up with some lax situations. Now, understand that has nothing to do with love. Because I'm sure Will still loves his children. as I still love mine. But I keep them tight rope, tight knit. And not what I believe, but in what God believes. What me and my wife believe that God says, we teach that. But the truth is, when they grow up and move out, they're going to do them. But my job is complete. Train up a child in the way they should go. When they get old, they will not depart from that. That's what my trust is. That's what my hope is. Okay? God's standard of love is love those who hate you. The Bible teaches four kinds of love. Write these down if you're a note taker and you can see where your love is. The first one is Euro love. Euros love. E-R-O-S love. This is the kind of love that arises from passion, infatuation, and sexual attraction. That's what that is. Most of us who are not married, when we find somebody we in a whole lot of life with, that's the kind of love you mean. Okay? You're infatuated. The second one is storge love. S-T-O-R-G-E love. This is the natural affection kind of love. It is like the love between a parent and its children. It's the love of a family and love toward one another. Amen. It's that natural kind of love that God has put into us. That I say when I'm hugging everybody but my wife. Oh, I love you, sis. Love you, bro. I have love in my heart and compassion in my heart for you. But it's not the kind of love when I say I love my wife toward any of you. Amen?
Amen.
If y'all, any of y'all thought anything other than that, let the record know that I don't love none of y'all the way I love my wife. I don't love my children in the way I love my wife. Because the love between me and my wife includes some of these other things that I cannot have with my children. Amen. That's folk messed up. Their minds starts burning. Something wrong with them when they're carrying out some of these kind of loves with their children. The third kind of love is filial love. P-H-I-L-E-O love. Filial love. This is known as brotherly love in the Bible. It's that deep, 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 deep friendship type of love. It's the filial love that you have toward the brethren. Amen?
Yeah.
See, there's a different love for the brethren than there's different love for my children, and there's a different love for my wife. And then there's the fourth one. The fourth one is agape love. A-G-A-P-E. Agape love. Now listen to this special kind of love. I started to pick out a song and have a brother Robson cue it up. Because this is a love right here. And it sounds like it ought to have some music behind it. Now, this kind of love is a love that gives, cares, sacrifices, works for another person, no matter the kind of response you receive. That's a love right there. I wish I had Teddy Pendergrass in the background. Yes, God made kind of love. You know, because this kind of love is between God No matter how you've treated him, no matter how you scandalize his name, God still loves you. And he tells us that we ought to have the same kind of love. Give me 5 more minutes and we're done. Amen. Do you remember what Moses told the people of God in Deuteronomy chapter 30, verses 19 and 20? Moses said, I have set before your life and death, blessings and cursings. Therefore, choose life, that both you and your descendants may live, that you may love the Lord your God, that you may obey his voice, and that you may cling to him, for his is your life and the length of your days. In order to broaden and widen your witness, God's thoughts must become your thoughts. God's ways must become your ways. And in spite of the love that we have for one another, we must tell each other the truth. And it's the truth of God that transforms. See, what God allows us to know, he says, we do not wrestle against flesh and blood. Why is all our battles amongst one another? So it's not against flesh and blood, but it is against the principality of darkness, the ruler of this world. That's the devil, y'all, just in case you don't know who it is. We're wrestling against that in which he has trying to make us fall. We've had some tragedies, some trials and tribulations in our life, but Jesus even clears that up. He says they come to make us strong. We gotta widen our witness. We can't be closed-minded to the person next to us. The person in front of us or in back of us, they got some problems too, and God has chosen us to help widen the witness of God. But we must stand in the gap. Must be used according to God's word. Amen? Amen? So the first thing we have to do, what is it? What's the first thing? The first thing we have to do is we have to allow Jesus to transform our traditions. The second thing we must allow him to do is allow Jesus to widen your witness. Next week we're going to finish this up with the third point. And the third point is allow Jesus to perfect your purpose. We need Jesus to perfect our purpose. Because if Jesus is not in our purpose, is it your purpose? Hello, somebody. If you're carrying out something and it's not God's purpose for your life, is it the purpose of God? I stop by to let you know that it's not it. Because regardless of what you think, it's not about you. Where you going, my baby? All right. God wants us to love as he has loved. In this season of love, Cupid shooting arrows. Get ready to be spring. They say when spring is in the air, love is in the air. Amen. But I want you to know that you have to widen your witness. God bless you. God keep you. I'm just teaching these 3 weeks. You have to come back another week for preaching. But this week we're just teaching. These weeks we really need to understand the love of God. And I'm so glad today that as I look around the house, we see a group of people who love God. And we see a group of people who love God according to his word and according to his purpose. As we open the doors of the church, I just stopped by to let you know that the love of God should transpire into the way you love. Hallelujah.
To the ground, God, but we realize and understand
that you are withholding nothing from us. That if we would surrender our lives and we would surrender our hearts unto you, God, that you would take care of us. You would do exceedingly abundantly more than we could ever ask or think. Father, we pray, oh God, that we would open up our ears as the word is preached unto us, that we would open up our ears and hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. And Father God, that we would in turn around and broaden our witness and broaden our love and love those that hate us. Love those that despitefully use us. And that we would, God, in turn pray for them and encourage them in the Lord. And that they would come to know the truth and allow the truth to make them free. Father, we thank you for this divine moment. We thank you for what you're doing in our lives. We thank you for this place called New Covenant. Father, continue to hold us by in the hollow of your hand and lead us unto righteousness. Father, we thank you. Father, we praise you and we glorify you. It is in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, we do pray. And the people of God say, amen.
Amen.
Amen.